to our Honorable Resource Person Dr. Arabind Manikrao Nawalekar, our Honorable Respected Principal Ma'am Dr. Ruprakha Pordle, though she is unable to attend the meeting today, then our respected Dr. Asna Bhattacharjee Ma'am, former HOD Department of English, and former IQSE Coordinator, then former Academic Vice Principal, then Mr. Tukhel Jilani Sir, Professor Department of English, as Joint Coordinator of this webinar, then Assistant Coordinator of IQSE, and all the members of Steering Committee, and my dear participants. On behalf of IQSE, myself, Dr. Nivedita Gogoi, Coordinator, welcome all of you to our today's webinar, that is Gender in Varied Dimensions. And today is the second day of our webinar, and today the theme would be Literature and Gender Inequality. So on behalf of our whole team, I welcome all of you. During this pandemic season, we are getting the opportunity to share the knowledge of various resource person. And today's resource person, Nawale Sir, far from Maharashtra, and he would deliver a topic on literature and gender inequality. So now I would like to request our Dr. Archana Bhattacharjee Ma'am to give a brief introduction of our Dr. Arvind Nawale Sir. Ma'am, would you please go?
Okay, thank you, Dr. Nivedita Gogoi. Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. So, good morning to everyone assembled for the second session of this international webinar on gender and different barriers.
Echo, please remove that echo sound. Some other device is working near you. Mute that device.
Okay.
Other device is working is on near you, probably mobile. That's why the echo is okay.
Just one. Is it okay now? Hello.
Okay, ma'am.
Am I audible?
Yes.
So, beautiful morning to everyone assembled here today for this virtual international webinar on gender and its varied dimension. And today we are privileged to have in our midst a renowned academician, a prolific writer, Dr. Arvind M. Nawale, who has entered our Kakonan College premises virtually. It's a great moment for me because I am proud to inform you all that he was my PhD guide. During my tenure in Kakojan College, I was not able to invite him for any international or national meet. So the COVID situation has given me the opportunity. So I really, really feel blessed. So to give you a brief introduction about Dr. Arvind Nawale, let me tell you, right now he's working as the head Department of English in Sivaji Mahavidyalaya, Udgir, Maharashtra. He has been teaching English language and literature for the last 23 years. He has authored, translated, co-edited, co-authored 47 books, made 24 research paper presentations. He has written more than 44 research papers for journals or book chapters. He has delivered more than 60 lectures at national seminars, workshops, conferences, and academic events, conducted 9 literary interviews, and has 5 book reviews to his credit. More than 30 books written by him are subscribed by world's renowned overseas libraries, including USA, UK, South Africa, Australia, Germany, France, Canada. He has also worked on various bodies and committees of different universities as member of the Senate and Board of Studies. At present, he is in the Board of Studies in English of SRTM University, Nanded, Maharashtra. He is also on the Editorial Advisory Review Board of more than a dozen prestigious international journals. He has successfully organized many events in his institutions, including one university-sponsored workshop, one NAC-sponsored National Conference, and very recently, one university-sponsored international webinar conference as convener. He has designed curriculum of undergraduate and postgraduate courses of SRTM University for 4 consecutive terms. He has also co-edited 7 and co-authored 2 textbooks. He is a recognized PG teacher and PhD supervisor. So far, 9 of his students have been awarded PhD and 5 students are working for the PhD. He has also worked for community as a former commission NCC officer in the rank of captain and as NSS program officer of this institution. Now, without taking more time in this introduction part, I would like to welcome and then request Dr. Arvind M. Nawali to our institution and request him to deliver his much awaited for lecture on literature and gender equality. But here I would like to inform Dr. Nawali as well as all the participants assembled here that due to certain emergency, I have to take my leave now, but I request my former departmental colleague, Mr. Tofel Jilani, assistant professor, to take over my responsibility. I express my heartfelt regret for my absence.
May I start?
Now I hand over to Dr. Arvind M. Nawali.
Shall I start?
Sir, it's over to you now. Okay, yes.
The organizers, Honorable Dr. Ruprekha Ji Bordovi, the principal of Kokujan College, Jorhat, Assam, Dr. Nibedita Ji Bogain, IQC coordinator, Dr. Dharmendra Ji Datta, Dr. Lakhya Nirmoli Ji,
Nirmolia.
Dr. Sufail Jilani Ji, Pallab Boraji, other members of the organizing team, and above all, Dr. Archana Bhattachar Ji, on whose invitation and insistence I have accepted this invitation due to my decade-long association with her. Tamil. A good morning to one and all. My co-panelist, Mrs. Hugh Thompson, South Africa, talked on gender issues in various dimensions before me yesterday in inaugural session, and now in this session it's my turn. As webinar theme and topic allocated to me directs, let us see literature and gender inequality, that is how gender issues, gender discrimination in general, and women in particular got projected in literature. First of all, I would like to say that we will see first what is gender inequality. On broader level, the gender inequality refers to unequal treatment or perceptions of individuals wholly or partly on basis of their gender. Here, we must understand that gender and sex are two different concepts. The term sex and gender are concepts used by academicians and researchers to express the biological and psychological differences between male and female. As a newborn is labeled as boy or girl, depending on genetic differences, that is the biological differences between their sexes. Most people are born, except for the third gender people, with any one specific sex. However, individuals born with a specific sex learns and responds according to the specific gender expectations and roles which they learn in due course of their life. Biological females are socialized to think, behave, and play feminine roles, whereas biological males socialized to think, behave, and play masculine roles. However, there are some feminist writers who do not agree it and consider sex as a biological and gender as a sociological construct. Gender does not refer to the physical attributes in terms of which men and women differ, but it refers to socially formed behaviors of masculinity and femininity. In short, sex is natural characteristics of human being, whereas gender is a man-made or a social concept. As the feminist writer Simone de Beauvoir puts it very correctly, one is not born a man but becomes one, and one is not born woman but becomes one. According to such sociological analysis of gender, sex is a property of biological characteristics of an organism, whereas gender is a socially construct, a social creation. This is a powerful and a total revolutionary idea. In it, we have the potential capacity to change the social relations in which we live, including the social relations between biologically defined men and women. Sometimes in the media, we hear a discussion in which someone talks about the gender of a dog. Sociological use of the term dogs don't have gender. Only people living within socially constructed relations are gendered. Then, where lies the roots of social construct form of a gender or gender inequalities? This is a question. And most accepted answer would be patriarchy, a term which has been used historically to refer to autocratic rule by a male head of a family. This concept of patriarchy was developed to explain male dominance as a social rather than biological phenomenon. Anthropological, archaeological, and evolutionary psychological evidences suggest that most prehistorical societies were relatively egalitarian, and that patriarchal social structure did not develop until many years after the end of the Ice Age. Following social and technological developments such as agriculture and domestication, or where the concept of the fatherhood took root as the beginning of the spread of patriarchy almost approximately about 6,000 years ago. Patriarchy is a commonly used term in the today conversation, which denotes male prejudices against women or male dominances over women. It explains how different societies construct male authority and power over females. In patriarchal society, women have to struggle to be educated, to have property, or to make choices regarding marriage and other aspects of life. Their life is controlled, whereas for men, their resources are a matter of right and can make choices that affect their lives. Thus, patriarchy is one of the most important causes of gender inequalities in the society. Even Plato wrote that woman's duty is looking after the property indoors and obeying her husband. The work of Aristotle portrayed women as morally, intellectually, and physically inferior to men. Women as the property of men claimed that women's role in society was to reproduce and to serve a man in the household, and male dominance over women is a natural and virtuous, which was his writing is stating. Indian society is no exception where it comes to patriarchy. As per its Western counterpart, in India too, the root cause of gender inequality is patriarchal system deeply rooted in Indian society. Our religious beliefs have made this system a legal and valid one. As Manu, the Hindu law giver, says, women are supposed to be in the custody of their father when they were children, in the custody of their husband when they are, when she is a wife, and custody of son when she is a mother. In any circumstances, she should not be allowed to assert her independence. This is the real status of women in India, no matter she is a Hindu, Muslim, Christian, or belong to any another religion. Due to this patriarchal system of gender inequality, the crime against women was increased day by day. Domestic violence, rape, sexual harassment, molestation, forced prostitution, sexual exploitation at workplaces were become common. Against this social unjust order and injustice on women, many feminist academicians, social workers, writers came forward and claim violence against women is the result of deeply rooted patriarchal culture that increases and rewards male dominance and give exposure to the same through their agitations, movements, and literary writings, and through it emerged a feminist school of thought. Feminism is a social movement primarily concerned with discrimination faced by women and their inferior position in a society because of their sex, and longs for women's empowerment. All feminists call for change in the social, economic, political, or cultural order to reduce and eventually overcome this discrimination against women. As far as feminism in India is concerned, like its feminist counterpart all over the world, feminists in India also fought for gender equality, for the right to work, for equal wages, for right of education, for fair treatment of women at home, as well as at workplace, and so on. If we consider literature as a reflection of our society and reality, that despite individual perceptions, it mirrors social manners, then it would be interesting to see portrayal of gender inequalities, women changing role, be they social, political, or economic, in the literature. How far text taught in primary schools to colleges and university to the religious texts and classics, women have held to several roles. Here too, it is being observed that while male characters have been given free rein to be and become what they like, even to fail if they choose, women characters have been returned to play and replay the same themes, limited as they are. Literature has witnessed the role of women evolving through ages, but until recent time, most of the published writers were men, and the portrayal of women in literature too was without doubt biased. Let us see how women were portrayed in literature through ages. Women in Greek mythology were perceived to be more as sexual objects than individuals. One would see that women's rights were very limited, and they were not allowed to express much of their freedom. Within this time period, women were blamed for wars. Women were blamed for destruction of towns. Women were blamed for the deaths of men. It was not likely to see goddesses using their powers for vengeance. Although the role of women was limited, the existence of godness attributed great amount of power to female characters. The women of the medieval time were surprisingly a lot more candid and sexual than one might expect of an era where the ideal of femininity was Mary, the mother of Jesus. In actuality, the women in the literature of the period, as well as the historical female figures, seemed to be torn between the ideal that the physical desires and domineering character. During the Victorian era, there was an unending debate over the roles of women. While the era was dominated by writers who treated women as angelic figures, innocent, physically weaker, and nothing less than the household commodities, Edwardian poetry spoke of women's right gathering much attention, feminism, and female getting out of their homes during the war times. Literature is no less prone to inequality than any of the other forms of artistic expression. The plight of women in the 18th and 19th century can be seen through the pages of the great literary works of the time. Held as great classical works of fiction, the authors often used the writer's word to express their societal representation and restrictions. Throughout history, women have always been made to walk three steps behind men. Considered to be the weaker and lesser sex, society has always had strict ideas regarding how women should dress, how they should act, and how they should behave both publicly and privately. Gender status in the Victorian era was based on a fixed structure that was dictated by social expectations. Traditionally, women have always been placed socially behind men and were expected to defer to men in every aspect of their lives. In the 19th century, for a woman to behave outside of the social box of appropriate behavior meant to her boycott and outcast. For example, throughout Pride and Prejudice, Jane Austen portrays such roles of women in the aristocracy and gentry, and she does so in a way that most women of the time would relate to. The boundaries and restrictions placed on women during the 19th century greatly influenced the style of writing during that period. Coming to the Indian scenario, we notice that in Hindu sculpture, the Vedas, the Puranas, and the Upanishads, women were given highly respected positions and regards. The Vedas, the Puranas, and the Upanishads are the mirrors, as it were, that reflect the glorious past of India, its history, its civilization, its language and literature, philosophy and theology. The Vedic tradition has held a high regard for the quality of woman, who is portrayed as the feminine embodiment of important qualities and powers. These poems include those of Lakshmi, the goddess of fortune and the queen of Lord Vishnu, Saraswati, the goddess of learning, Durga, the goddess of strength and power, and the like. There are also Sati, Sita, Anusaya, Arundhati, Draupadi, Queen Kunti, and so on. However, on the contrary, in Manusmriti, the secondary and degraded position is given to women. The dawn of a new era of modern Indian literature may be said to ignite in the late 19th century. In the writings of this time, the impact of Western civilization, the rise of political consciousness, and the change in society was perceptible. A large number of writers made synthesis between Indianization and Westernization in their search for a national ideology. In the meantime, the Indian feminism too advanced by the stimuli of Western feminism. However, it took slightly different route from that of the West. All these attitudes were combined to bring about the renaissance in 19th century India. The majority of these novels depict the psychological suffering of the frustrated housewives. That subject matter often been considered superficial compared to the depiction of repressed and oppressed lives of women of the lower caste. Toward the beginning of 20th century, Indian English literature started moving away from projecting women as highly desirable damsels or vicious women. It started recognizing women as a cultural participant in the freedom movement and as gear in the wheel of national development. Yet, difference of sexual orientation and women's supposed difference from men has been used over centuries to justify discrimination against women and their exclusion from full social and political citizenship. In present days, Indian writing in English has acquired a great significance. Indians are using the English language as a medium of creative expression. The male as well as women novelists have put an ineradicable mark in the literary world. The prominent Indian writers in English highlighted the issues, problems, and experiences of contemporary Indian society. They have focused their writing on women and their world and discussed about the deprivation and suffering inflicted upon them. These writers include R.K. Narayana, Raja Rao, Mulk Raj Anand, Bhavani Bhattacharya, Anita Desai, Anita Nair, Shashi Deshpande, Manju Kapoor, Mulk Raj Anand, Arundhati Roy, Bharati Mukherjee, and so on. All these writers have depicted the struggle of female protagonists against patriarchal society, male-dominated attitude of society, traditional order and system, and gender inequality. Mulk Raj Anand projects women, whether she is rich or poor, as a marginalized being. Anand's women are silent sufferers and constantly being victimized in the patriarchal world. In his Untouchable, Anand presents his long preserved feeling for protest against Indian caste system. Sohini. Sohini's portrayal in Untouchable is social and religious hypocrisy. She was molested by Pandit Kali, which shows that how the people of upper caste use religion for their own sectarian benefit and surpassing the people in general and women in particular of lower caste. R.K. Narayana is by no means a feminist writer, but the theme of emancipation of a new woman finds its expression in some of the text. For example, The Guide. In it, Narayana presents the Indian society where women have been the victim of circumstances and conventions in form of Rosie, its character. The Guide presents the traditional Indian where women have no opportunity for expressing their talent. Raja Rao always portrays women keeping in the mind the scriptures of Manusmriti, which shows the duties and behaviors of women. The serpent and the rope describes that woman has to marry whether she is blind, deaf or mute. Your Bhavani Bhattacharya ji in So Many Hungers projects Kajoli as a rustic girl who is raped by a soldier. Most of the rustic and downtrodden women are destitute to brothel after rape. But Kajoli, for her dignity and self-respect, rejects it. Kamala Markandeya has portrayed different images of women in her novels. For example, in Nectar, in a Sieve, Rukmini is a child bride of 12 years of her husband, Nathan, a poor farmer. In it, Markandeya portrays the image of Rukmini and her daughter, Ira, who sacrifice their happiness for the sake of family, an embodiment of the family woman who can do anything for their families. Another, Anita Desai. Anita Desai's novel focuses on the tormented, trodden image of women and the struggle of women against the male-dominated world. Her Cry the Peacock and The Voices in the City deal with depressed housewives in altogether different way. In Cry the Peacock, Maya, the protagonist, has to suffer as her husband can't understand her vicious needs, while in Voices in the City, Monisha suffers due to husband's insensibility as well as the cruel nature of mother-in-law. In the novel, Where Shall We Go This Summer, Desai presents the predicament of a married woman who wants to win over the difficulties and suffering of her wife. Whereas in the novel, Fire on the Mountain, she records the story of Nanda Kaur, the vice chancellor's wife, who was fed up with only the duties and responsibilities of her position without any love attached to it, and her disillusionment, with her selfish, infidel husband, who treated her simply as some useful object. In God of Small Thing, Arundhati Roy questions certain social, economical, and political structures that have got patronage of the male dominance over centuries and crossed the borders into a democratic socialist India, and portrays some representative women characters who are either empowered or in need of empowerment. Next, in Shashi Deshpande's Dark Holds No Terror, the protagonist, a medical doctor, finds herself treated brutally by her husband because she does much better in her profession. There is a discord in her marital life, the discord for which she returns to her home. Kamala Das. Kamala Das, in her letter, My Story, speaks candidly of her struggles and offers her readers an important insight into many significant issues that continue to be central to the lives of women we find everywhere, even today. Then we can see Shobade. Shobade's women break all sorts of taboos and feel liberated, her novels present the vital reality and creates awareness of women's miseries and injustices subjected to them by their counterparts in the patriarchal society. Manju Kapoor. Manju Kapoor's all novels depicts the misery of the woman. Her difficult daughter portrays the suffering of a woman protagonist, Virmati, and her Virmati's endeavors against our odds in a search of self-dignity and self-identity in the male-dominated world. Whereas her novel Married Woman explores the suffering of Asha in her search for self-identity, in which she finds no room of her own, even being in her own home or in her own society. Kapoor's another novel, Home, explores Nisha's plight in a large jointly family and show how she gets subjugated treatment being a girl and becomes the victim of a domestic violence. Her another novel, The Immigrants. In The Immigrants, we see Nina's husband, who was important, but he blames Nina as infertile, and Nina has to suffer throughout the novel and throughout her life. One more thing I have to note here, that some Dalit women writers like Baby Kamble, Pratnya Pawar, Chaya Kuregaonkar, Silpi Kamble have interpreted and reconstructed the realities of their generated existence through their text. Baby Kamble's The Prison We Broke depicts the pathetic condition of Mahar women and the causes of their exploitation, which many times was resulted in to a forced sex trafficking. Even Dalit male writers projected the pathetic conditions of women in their writings. Sharan Kumar Limbade's autobiography, Outcast, that is a translation of Akkar Masi, I think, tries to depict the humiliation of Kaikadi community women in Indian social order. Even Lakshman Gaikwad's Branded, the translation of Uchlya. Yeah, in which he made a record of inhuman treatment and the stigma of a robber on par with women in the caste hierarchy. Even Lakshman Mane's autobiography, Upra, which got translated in English as Outsider, tries to depict the humiliation of Kaikadi community women in Indian social order. Such literary texts have analyzed, viewed, and investigated the gender inequalities and subjugations of women and they project it in their text. These texts are helping us to understand the plight of women in our society. The empowerment of women, which is the concern of various schools of development, has become one of the most important concerns of 21st century, not only at the national but also at international level. And in this scenario, such text, such literature will help us to understand the actual subjugation of the woman and actual status of the woman, which will help us, will help the policymaker and the government to formulate the policy in order to empower them. The empowerment of women is the prerequisite to transfer a developing country to a developed country. It is surprising that in spite of so many laws, women still continue to live under stress and strains. The government initiatives alone would not be sufficient to achieve this goal. Society must take initiative to create a climate in which there would be no gender discrimination and women have full opportunities. The literature in the social tool, the literature as a social tool for reshaping the societies and the nations, holds the mirror in front of society and shows the picture and leave it to us to take decision. Literature can play a significant role in making people aware of various deformities of the society and thereby making them prepared for facing the same. Literature has had a major impact on the development of society. It has saved civilizations, changed the political systems, and exposed injustice. As far as the delineation and the gender disparity of women and women's plight in the society is concerned, literature has done its job in order to create an awareness of it. And now it's our turn. Now it's your turn. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Ashana ji and all the original team for inviting me and making part of this service gathering. Thank you.
Hello.
I'm very happy. I would be very happy if there are some questions. I would like to interact with the participants.
Hello, sir. It's very informative and
thank you. Valuable.